This week, the Victorian Parliament passed the Anti-Conversion Bill, which is aimed at outlawing and stopping practices to try and convert people from being gay. Now, one member of the upper house who voted against the legislation was Liberal Democrat David Limbrick. Welcome to the Sky Studios, David.
Thanks for having me.
Well, David, you voted against this bill. It has been hugely topical and controversial, it has to be said, but you voted against it. Is that because you think gay people are broken and need to be fixed?
Jesus.
Absolutely not. So I don't have any objection to outlawing coercive practices, and if that's all that this bill did, then I would have totally supported it. It goes far, far further than that, and one of the things that it does is it outlaws and allows the government to interfere in consensual relationships between adults. And we met with a lot of stakeholders and spoke about this, but ultimately no one could convince me and my team on why the government should interfere with the consenting relationships between adults.
Well, you voted for same-sex marriage, and you're saying
yes.
For the very similar reasons you voted against this bill. Explain that to us.
Exactly the same reason. So exactly the same reasons why our party supported same-sex marriage, that the government shouldn't interfere in consenting relationships, is exactly the same reason why we oppose this. It's also this idea that the government should interfere in consenting relationships between adults. Let's remember, this is the same type of thinking that led to homosexuality being outlawed back in 1958 in the first place. So this is a very dangerous precedent when we have the government interfere in consenting relationships. This was also a concern that, you know, there was an emergency letter written by the Law Institute of Victoria on this exact topic. They suggested that the bill should be amended so that only coercive or relationships where people couldn't form consent should be covered by this law. But ultimately the law was passed so that even where consent exists, that third parties could make a complaint and, you know, dob people in and investigations could be started.
So, David, the bill makes quite clear that there are exemptions for health professionals to provide counselling to people who are suffering or going through dysphoria or seeking advice about their sexuality. It also does not in any way preclude parental conversations with children. So don't you worry that maybe you have allowed yourself to be persuaded by some pretty unfortunate and untruthful commentary that's been made about this bill?
No, not at all. We made up our own mind based on the consent angle only. I mean, I'm not coming at this from a religious view whatsoever. And when we first started consulting on this bill, I did have a lot of concerns, but after going through a wide consultation, I found that, you know, most of those concerns that I had were unfounded, but ultimately this consent issue is a sticking issue. It's a fundamental principle for us that the government should not interfere in the consensual relationships between adults. And there's a number of situations that we've discussed in the course of this. You know, if you have a situation where a man is, for example, married, they have children, later in life they discover that they're same-sex attracted. Now, this is not an uncommon scenario. Now, that man may, for example, choose to, in order to keep his family together, he may choose to make a sacrifice to suppress that part of his sexuality. And what this law will do will outlaw anyone providing him assistance to do that. And I haven't been convinced on why that scenario, which I see as, you know, valid, you know, whether people like what he would choose or not, it seems an entirely reasonable
choice.
But
David, isn't that almost missing the major point here? And what I've read from the National Association of Practicing Psychiatrists, the Royal Australian New Zealand College of Psychiatrists, we've had legal experts, we've had women's groups all come out and have serious concerns about aspects of this legislation and what impact it has with trans children who are confused about their gender and whether this legislation is going to criminalise therapy. And Professor Patrick Parkinson says that this is based on false unscientific beliefs, and that science does not in any way support the criminalisation of therapy for children and young people who identify as trans. So isn't that the real danger here, that kids that are confused are not going to be given all the information, aren't going to be counselled against perhaps waiting until they're 18 before they submit to treatment that is irreversible in some cases and has all sorts of medical consequences, whether we're talking hormones or medical procedures, surgeries?
Look, there were a lot of concerns that were put to us around the idea that, medical professionals might be caught up in this if they're urging people to adopt a wait-and-see approach. And that was certainly something that was discussed at length in Parliament last night. Look, I think in a lot of the situations, these would be covered by exemptions for medical professionals as long as they, adhered to certain ethical codes of conduct. So I'm not too sure that this legislation would have caused a lot of troubles there. But ultimately, the main point for us revolved all around consent. Now, obviously, that doesn't apply to children. We're talking about consenting adults here.
Yeah, I'm just shocked that the Victorian Coalition were so weak on this, Nicholas. They really didn't put up much of a fight at all. And I think they fell into the trap, which you are trying to push, that this is, if you're against this bill, then you're for gay conversion therapy. Now, gay conversion therapy, I'd love for you to find me some examples of that happening now. If it is, ban it, prosecute those. This bill does a lot more than that. David Limbrick, thank you for joining us.